Thank you very much. This is really a special occasion, and for me it's the first time when I will speak just in this style of presenting mathematics and the life outline of a person. But so Victor Havin was an indubitable leader of St. Petersburg analysis for many, many decades, and he passed away suddenly this fall in 21st September. And so he has a very huge influence for the developing of analysis in St. Petersburg during the whole half of the last century. But as many pillars of our culture, our civilization, he was a little bit hidden in some shadow, and his role is really is not not really evaluated, excepting locally in St. Petersburg. But in general, he is not so known, and I'd like to shed some light on his personality and his mathematics. So I start with some life sketch of Havin. So Victor Havin, in fact, in Russian, Victor Petrovich Havin, of course. And say for me, he was never Victor, but always Victor Petrovich, because he was my PhD thesis director and just the respected person. And this is, you can see the typical gesture of the man of having here in 30 years old and 75 years old, it's still even the same. And here is working on mathematics, and here in the conference in St. Petersburg. So he was born in 33 in a very cultural family. His father was a very known philology professor in St. Petersburg University and founder of the chair of Russian Slavistics. And his mother was a violinist in symphony orchestra in St. Petersburg. So they well survived during the catastrophe of the Second World War in the Middle Asia, the town of Tashkent in Uzbekistan. And then so he returned to St. Petersburg and having started his studies in St. Petersburg University. There is no pointer. So here in the photo, this young man is just a student of the fourth year in the university. Then so he graduated in 1958 he made his studies at the university, then the graduate study, what is called in Russian aspirantura, and working with Vladimir Smirnov, a very known expert in complex analysis, and Leonid Kantarovich, a functional analysis specialist, who solved or almost the Monge problem, and invented of the so-called measure displacement displacement method in functional analysis, and in economics. And this is maybe one of mathematicians who take Nobel Prize, but not in mathematics, in economics. And he take his PhD degree in 59. I mention also some political events of the time, because it was important for all people living in the Soviet Union, and in particular this Dr. Killer's plot in before and after Stalin's death was influenced in particular for Victor Havin as a Jew. He became a professor, first assistant professor in 59, then evoluted to associate and the full professor. And here you can see his official photo when he takes so-called docent diploma and the associate professor position. And here is another particularity of the Soviet, former Soviet life, that a kind of Chinese physical re-education. All people, including the famous professors, like here, should go from time to time to the country field to work physically, say, here just taking the potatoes and this person is the deputy director of the Department of Mathematics at this time, who just went to this field saying, having that for a good behavior and following this physical re-education, he will take this associate professor position. That's okay. From 62 began what we call Havin Analysis Seminar in St. Petersburg. And he started with my participation from the beginning. In 62, I was a student in the third year, or even second year of the university, with just three participants and Havin himself. So it was Vinogradov, my friend, who is died, and Solovyov, and another Havin students, and me. And then so it grows slowly first, but until 1970, it became already the big and competent circle of mathematicians. And from the 80s, it became a huge seminar, like not like this hall, but almost the half or three thirds. It's crowded, many people in the big hall, and every seminar was just some event. It was thoroughly planned. There was a program for each semester, fill it in from the beginning, from all dates given, and was some kind, in fact, of the institute, and not just a place to give a little talk. Okay, Havin has many international contacts, but mostly in letters. He has a very huge amount of his archive, but never come outside of the country up to 74, where he started slowly with Cuba and Czechoslovakia and some other so-called socialist countries. And it was related also to some political events. It was, I mean, not related, but we cannot isolated of these events. So the very big changes in the Havin's life was with the break of Soviet Union, because this famous seminar almost stopped to function, because most of the people go abroad, in particular me. And here is just some, I can say, divorce point of us. We regard it in different directions here, because Havin's still at place, and me go in France. And but however, it opens the door, and he start to realize his large international contacts, and go to many countries, and received quite a lot of honors from different universities, in particular here from Linköping University in Sweden, his first doctor honoris causa, and here he is with Paul Kusis and Stas Smirnov, the future Fields Medalist and the student of Havin. Here in McGill in Montreal. So he received also some honors, like Spencer Lecturer in Kansas and Zegger Professor in Trondheim. Finally, distinguished, very small, in fact, distinction, which is called Distinguished Researcher of the Russian Federation, and the Chebyshev Prize of Petersburg City Council. So now I will mention some Havin research. What is from the beginning he was in a strange manner. He was a kind of autodidact. In fact, there was quite important community, mathematics community in St. Petersburg, and he worked in analysis, in particular the old Fichtengoids from the beginning of 20th century, professor with a gross stature, and the author of textbooks in analysis, Vladimir Smirnov, very active in the 30s in complex analysis, in particular, who discovered the famous so-called Niven-Lindner-Riesz factorization, but in fact it's 5 or 10 years earlier was discovered by Smirnov, and Kantarovich, who I mentioned already. But however, Havin was has the stipend to continue his studies in doctoral school of St. Petersburg University, but with Kantarovich, who at this moment was already applied so-called his as a mathematician. He was an expert of optimization problems, of extremal problem in linear analysis. But he started to apply it to economics, and if economics, so some links with politicians, with some. So he just said, Havin, that you are free to choose your subject. So it's, and he looked himself for to do, and started with some problem. I will describe it in so-called soft classical analysis of the beginning of 19th century, but evolved quite rapidly to the hard analysis with the estimates, singular integrals, and so on. So formally, I can say Here he made what many strong professional mathematics made. So about 100 papers published in good journals and two books, very influential. But in fact, as I mentioned, his particular force and influence was not only here in the published papers. I will speak about it. But first of all, some mathematics, and I will speak on some maybe less known results, Havin results, because on the more recent and more known maybe, the next speakers of this session will speak in more details. So he started with the problem of so-called separation of singularity. Of singularities. Which is the following. So take an open set in the complex plane and some subset S of omega, which is relatively closed here. And imagine that S is the union of two subsets, S1 and S2. So like this, it's omega, is S. So we have, say, S1 and S2, also relatively closed. So maybe intersection is not empty, is not. And then the following theorem holds, and I will speak about the history of this theorem where Havin participated. Yeah. So the theorem is the following. Given a function which is holomorphic in the complement omega minus s, so we can say that f is holomorphic in omega with the singularities on s. There is or not, but however, if they exist, they are on s. Then there exist the functions fj holomorphic on the omega minus sj, j equal to 1, 2. So I can say which can be extended holomorphically, say, in the complement of S1 or in the complement to S2, such that F is the sum of F1 on the omega minus S plus F2 restriction to omega minus S, okay? And this is, so the function with the singularities on this set S is the sum of two with the smaller sets of singularity. And they can say that the singularities of S are separated. The first version of the theorem was proved by Henri Poincaré in his memoir of Fuchsian functions here for the case where omega is equal to the complex plane and S1 is the half line and S2 is the half line positive. So this is like this, and the holomorphic extension for the first function is here, and for the function F1 and for the second one, it is here. And the initial function F It is just, in fact, two functions, the holomorphic function in the upper and in lower half plane. And by the way, later on, much later on, it was approved by Mityagin and Henkin. Mityagin, Henkin, in the 80s, that in this case there is no linear separation. So there is no linear right inverse to the there is okay. So I will. There is no linear separation, and if we denote by G, say the operator from the space of holomorphic function in omega 1, omega 1, this omega without the singularity, direct product with the omega 2 holomorphic functions in omega, which is just gf1 f2 is equal to the sum of omega plus f2 and omega, then, so what I said, that this mapping has no right, it is surjective. So what means that it is the whole omega, but there is no R from this space to the product space, H1, H2, this one, and each one, such that this is the identity. The reasons are quite profound, in fact, because if such a linear extension exists, then the product Rj in the different direction is a projection, and if you consider it, it is a projection on the diagonal. On the diagonal of this direct product, it's impossible. It's not complementable in view of the difference of epsilon entropies of the compacts in the space. And this is a lot of works. But having participated in this story just in the beginning in his PhD thesis, and his paper of 59, just is this statement. So not some particular cases, but just the general one. And yeah, it is a quite dramatic story, which was not so seldom in the former Soviet Union and in any countries which are isolated from the exterior, because he was not informed, and neither Kantarovich or Smirnov or some other people, about some very long paper by Arenstein published in Acta Mathematica, who just proved this theorem with a very, very complicated method. A proof is about 100 pages of in Arenstein, and based on Runge approximation theorem. So he approximated the function f by rational functions, and then separated thoroughly the poles of this rational approximation into groups and pass it to the limit. Very complicated reasoning. Havin's proof is here. It is so simple that I can present it in 2 minutes and very elegant. So for simplicity, I will consider the case of the whole complex plane. So our omega j is the complement of fj, and s is this union, And the first remark is the, here's the duality. In fact, the method is the duality, and the duality with the holomorphic function on an open set is so the dual space is a holomorphic function on S. So I mean that if we have S here, and so this is functions which are holomorphic in some neighborhood of S, which depends on this function with some complicated topology. But however, we have this one, and it is reflexive. So we have this formula. The duality is made by just Cauchy integral. You have some contour which separated in Cauchy formula, and this is so integral sum gamma f g d dz, where f is analytic in the neighborhood of the singularities, and g is holomorphic in the complement. Okay, and every function f holomorphic in the complement of S give a linear functional on the holomorphic function on S. Okay? So we interpret, now we can easily interpret holomorphic functions on S as a diagonal of the direct product. Where is some things to erase? No? Huh? Oh, yeah, it says blue thing. Okay, yeah, thanks. We can consider this L as a functional on the diagonal of holomorphic functions on S1 and S2, not diagonal, but just f minus f, the pairs f1 f2 such that the sum is equal to zero on the common part of the definition. So and then because the spaces, at least the spaces of holomorphic function on a, open set are Fréchet spaces, so we can use, no, but all in general, we can use the Hahn-Banach theorem and extend LF to a functional L on the whole diagonal. S2, and then so so this is the extension, so L so it's get exactly because L is an extension of LF, it implies immediately that we have this decomposition of the function f in the sum of two, which L generate, of course, so I can write that this dual space is the sum, of course, of dual spaces of here by the usual formula, and so we will take this this decomposition. So it's very. There are some technical details, mostly topological, and say for a compact S, it's like SI written, but for the general there is some work, but it's technical. And very simple.
HS was the space of functions holomorphic in the neighborhood of S, is it?
Yeah. No, but in some neighborhood. So oh, it is the inductive limit. So as the holomorphic on open is the projective, and this is just inductive limit. And but the duality holds always. And at this point, it is quite new because this is the Goethe theory, which is just published in the end of the 50s. So it is the first Havin impact. Of course, the interesting question is whether we can continue and find some spaces different, say, different letter, capital H. Some space is different from the space of all holomorphic functions, such that we have this representation in the same notations. And especially interesting where the capital H is H infinity simply. So we consider the bounded holomorphic function. In this case, of course, capital omega is not the whole complex plane, but is the unit disk or the half plane or something like this. And in this case, so the theorem was proved for many spaces of holomorphic functions like Bergman spaces and some. But for H infinity, this is particularly resistant, of course. And the problem is not solved. It is well open, but there are some results, some number of publications, and the one of the last one is in you, where Havin participated, and this is Havin, Nersesian, and Ortega Cerda. In which year? It's recent. It's recent. 2007. Who just considered the case when S1 and S2, so a continuum. I mean, some connected sets, but even some curves in some rectifiable curves in the unit disk. And the result is that the this solution with H infinity, so for bounded, is possible only for transversal case when S1 and S2 in just they regarded only the case when the intersection is equal to one point or even empty. This is also of interest. I mean that you have, say, two curves which may be approach but have no intersection. And in this case, so this transversality condition holds, and it means that you have separate the curve with some angle. And then you can the answer is positive. If not, so if there is a tangent case, so the answer is negative. The solution goes by the by the bar equation, of course. So, and of this kind, so for every h infinity function, this equation should have the bounded solution, where c is a cutoff function, which is, say, c infinity, and equal to 1 on S1 and 0 on S2. So we have this function, and if you can solve it in bounded function, so you can do it, of course, very technical and very, very... But in general, there is not even the conjecture of what it depends. Yet another early paper by Havin is the solution, the so-called Golubev problem. The Golubev problem was it is known in Russia, at least in this name of Golubev problem, but maybe the question was asked by somebody like Adamar or Weierstrass, even, I don't know, because it is a generalization of the Lorentz series representation for functions having the singularity on the larger set than one point. So you know that if you have function which is holomorphic, say c minus not zero, so the f is developed in Lorentz series with an 1 over n tending to zero. And Havin's theorem answering Golubev. Golubev was a complex analysis mathematician from the 30s and make some important contribution here, but I don't remember what exactly. So the Golubev problem and the solution, so the Havin theorem was the following. If we have some closed subset F in the complex plane, compact. Just closed, just closed subset, and the function which is holomorphic in the complement. So F is the point here in the classical situation. Then F is the sum of the power-like series of the following form. So we take F, and we also fix a measure whose support is this set F. Mu is a measure. With the support equal to F. Okay? Then there exists functions yk in L2 of mu such that F of z is equal to what they called Golubev series integral over F. Yk of t minus z k plus 1 d mu of t and the norms of yk in L2 of mu 1 over k tends to 0. And this is the analog of the Lorentz series. And of course, there is a link with the previous problem, because if your set F is the union of F1, F2, and you have such a representation, so it's very easy to separate the singularity just integrating by the complement F2 or F1. Okay, there was some curious point here, because the proof depends. The theorem. I not stated it for arbitrary closed set, so I give some statement here, but we need to precise what is F. In fact, for a moment, it is proved for F which are connected. The most closed connected set. Because the proof and maybe the validity of this theorem depends on the following property, the property of F. So that if we have a function f which is holomorphic on f, not in the complement but on f, because the method of the proof is the duality as before. On f, and such that, so for every lambda in f, we have the upper limit of fk of lambda over k factorial, 1 over k is finite, okay? And if we suppose that it's less than r, so the property is that for every r, there exists a neighborhood u of f, such that f coincide with and the function g holomorphic on f or on u, such that f equal to g on another smaller neighborhood of f. Okay, so I mean that if the small germs of our function can be extended to the circle of radius r, which is uniform on the whole set, f can be unbounded. It can be not compact. And even if it's compact, then we need to have the global holomorphic function, which gives this such that f coincides with this global holomorphic function. It is very easy to see that for locally connected sets, this property holds. For a compact set, it fails in principle. So if f, say, is equal to 0, and then 1 over n, from 1 to infinity, so just a sequence of points, 1/2, and then tending to then the counterexample is here. We take a line in between of this number and with say n. It's the nth number, 1 over n, 1 over n plus 1. And we take fn of z is equal to 0 to the left and 1 to the right. Then this limit r of lambda for every lambda of f, r of lambda is equal to infinity in this case, because it is constant. But there is no neighborhood of this set where all functions can be analytically extended. And for the case of arbitrary connected set, the statement, this property holds true, but the proof is not simple and not even elementary. And found by Varfolomeev, a student of Havin, in the 80s, and he was a student of, I think, even third year's university when he proved this theorem. And after he died dramatically, suicided in with some unhappy love story. In fact, so I'd like to address to the women mathematicians: be careful with in these cases. Okay, so just rapidly, I will finish with my formal slides. So he solved this Golubev problem in this case. When then, after there was some series of very interesting papers where he compared the strengths of different norms on finite dimensional spaces of polynomials, which you can consider now as a preparation to the famous, after famous theorem of Kasnitson-Kahan, and I forget the third
people,
Delu, on the Fourier coefficients of holomorphic function with the Kislyakov addition on the disk algebra in this, but I cannot the time to consider it. After, there was many series of profound papers in rational approximation in the principle of half smoothness of holomorphic function f in terms of of the modulus. I mean, there is an expert of this subject here, Professor Diakonov, and it seems, for instance, that if you have on the unit disk Lipschitz function, then and f is holomorphic and Lipschitz in the closed unit disk, then f is only Lipschitz of the order alpha over 2, generally, not better. This is a Havin discovery of this formula. And then, say, a very interesting impact about weak completeness of the quotient space L1. It is not reflexive space, of course. The reflexive spaces are all weakly sequentially complete. But there are some non-reflexive. And for the whole L1 space, this is a very elementary fact presenting, say, in Danforth monograph. But for the holomorphic function, and this, where is holomorphy? Because the dual of this quotient is H infinity in U. And so this space is holomorphic. And Havin proved it, but after he recognized that Mooney proved this before, and Erik Amar proved in the same time by the different method. And the method contains in all presentations of some approximative solution of some Bizou corona equations in H infinity. So the big discovery was the uncertainty principle for convolution operator, which also I cannot time to explain. I mean the following property that if E is, say, a subset of R and the function such that we have this one, it implies or not that F is zero everywhere. And so to characterize the convolutor S and the class of the sets E such that this property holds. This is a harmonic analysis analog of the famous uncertainty principle of Heisenberg. And then, so he worked on Cauchy problems for Laplacian with some co-authors and for approximation by harmonic vector fields. And the last big theme was so-called admissible majorant for model spaces, which is related to famous series of Berlin-Malevin theorem about multipliers and about the completeness problem for exponential. And the results are very, very interesting and considerable here. And maybe Anton Baranov will speak about it in more details. So the seminar and the Havin teaching activity continuing for many decades. So he was director of the thesis for 31 people, including three Salim Prize winners, Alexandrov, Nazarov, and Smirnov. And I hope that all people here know these names. And so the number of descendants is 135. It's not so, not, it's good result, but of course, so the question is not in numbers. There are, say, if you consider Gilfand, so it will be 2,000 or 3,000 here. And if you consider some, even Danforth or not saying Hilbert, where is tens of thousands of descendants. But the question is not in number. The question is in influence, in the spreading mathematics, because Havin produced many people who became in its own very influential mathematics, like, say, among all these 135, there is already 9 Salim Prize winners, with Wolberg, Triel, Makarov, Peter Mikl, Dapeng, Dmitry Chilkak, the last one, and finally the Fields Medal of Stas Smirnov in 2010. In seminars, there was a lot of people. When the country was open, it was very important for the development of seminar. And so this is my opinion about Viktor Petrovich. And in particular, so I cannot time, and maybe it's not a good place to speak a lot on his personal character. He was very patient, very, very indulgent to all hard things in the Russian life, and he was some example for all of us, I can say. So, what next? Because in the title of my talk is what next? I don't know. So this is the answer. But however, I can suppose that the hard spaces will be, and maybe this is just in process, replaced by so-called debranche spaces. So the spaces with more complicated and specific reproducing kernels. Because there is a lot of indications of the importance of this paper. It was started by Louis Debranche in 59 in his book, which is called Square Summable Power Series, and is absolutely unknown. I think nobody read it except me here. No, I'm sorry, because this is the case. And it was a textbook. He read it very thin textbook of presentation of complex analysis. In the first page, the definition of the complex number, and in the last one is the model for the string theory in the Debranche spaces. It was awful experience of teaching, and he was fired immediately from the department. They have big problems with the authorities. But he continued to insist in this case. And in 1984, he came in St. Petersburg in our seminar with another book, which is called Complementary Metrics Approach to Extremal Problem, 400 pages, with the proof at the last page of the non-Bieber-Bakken conjecture. Then they worked on this proof because there was many technical tips and mistakes. And finally, all the branches approach disappear from the final proof. But we returned to the question, and there is a proof, it's published, where exactly his initial idea. And initial idea why Bieber-Bach inequality is so difficult and why it resists. Because it is some extreme problem, of course. And it is a problem on the length of some geodesic in some complementary space defined by the branch in this famous square sum of power theory. There is some procedure when you have a Hilbert space and the subspace which is not closed with the stronger scalar product, the subspace of this Hilbert space, you can define some kind of complementary reproducing kernel and complementary Hilbert matrix, which in sum gives the initial metric. And this procedure exactly was used in the original proof of the Bieber-Bach, and he supposed, Louis de Branche, that the same is true, say, for Riemann hypothesis, because there is an approach where the equivalent form of Riemann hypothesis in terms of the branches spaces. What means, so roughly speaking, this is a orthogonal complements of shift invariant subspaces. And it appears in Niemann-Berling Bayes-Duarte equivalent form for Riemann hypothesis. So it's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions or comments, which you will have to use the microphone. This is a request here, but it shouldn't stop you.
Yeah, it is about the separation of singularities.
Yeah.
So having done that in 1959, uh-huh. and it's in fact the basis of cohomology theory, modern cohomology theory,
yeah.
and seminar, and Carton yeah. seminar was only in the yeah. 60s, so it's, uh-huh. it was later. Uh-huh. And so we recognize the
yeah.
maybe
yeah, yeah, of course, of the using of the modern language of Cauchy complex and so on. It is a partial case of Cousin problem for yeah. one variable, and it was also recognized by Havin, but much later on, because as I said, he started as a self-deduct. He was not. Yeah.
But even Carton's seminar was later. It was later. Carton's
no, but however, it could be. And he started slightly with a very classical approach to this mathematics, and Banach space approach, and the Hart analysis came later, 10 years later in some. Yeah, but it's a bit earlier, yeah.
So soft was probably application of Hahn-Banach.
Yeah, right.
And then
yeah.
hard was
right. Yeah,
later.
Yeah. Some inequalities. Hard, it's inequalities. Yes. It is.
But already the fact that there is no linear lifting was harder.
Oh no, it is different.
Yes,
but
yes.
Say it is not present in Poincaré. In Poincaré, of course, exactly there is no. But sometimes maybe. There is the linear extension operator. It is just the particularity when S divided in two domains of the whole omega. If not, it's maybe possible.
Are there?
Yes, sure.
Sorry.
Yes, there is no linear continuous right inverse, but is it useful in some cases that there is a right continuous inverse combining with Michael's selection?
No, but it is just what I mentioned just now. So I think yes, but I never saw it in written form. I think that there is some cases when S does not divide the whole domain in two non-intersecting subdomains, when say the complex plane and the union of S1 and S2 is a compact set. I think it's maybe, no, not.
But Michael's selection theorem was done almost simultaneously.
Well, some in a, it is a, in a part of unsolved problem. Maybe it's an interesting question. Yeah.
Any other comment? Okay, I don't see any, so let's thank the speaker again. Thank you.